Is that true? What anyone said? Just ignore it. Don't magnify it. So if people have problems, don't let that come as a filter to see the person. Now that is growth. That is growth. If someone, if I see Ken as a struggle, and if I see it through that, I will not only fully respect her for how God made her, transformed her, that she'll tell her God, but also I will see her less than who she is. God sees her. And also, I'm not returning the gossip. It's not care of this. It's not this one. It's not this. But if I see that person as God sees her, through the lens of Christ, I won't be able to see her like that. Regardless of the issues in her body or soul. You get the point? So initially, I want to see. So when Sean sat next to me, I'm telling Sean because it just really happened and he's there. I'm not like him. I can't like him. He's that man sitting up here. So, and he's very open about everything. So when he sat in front of me 1.5 ago, 2 months ago, and just, I think almost weeping, and telling the problems he's involved at the moment, his struggles. And I listened to him for a while and said, no, I contradicted everything he said. And told him how, and I was not making it up. I was real. I was genuine. I was not just telling, for sake of telling. I was just genuine. And then from that point of view, began to say, this is just a problem. It's a small issue. Let's remove this issue so the real you could manifest. Hallelujah. You get the point? Just like this. Right. Second verse, Matthew 12, 28. But if I cast out, the kingdom of God could manifest. Amen. Amen. You have a point? Yes.
I think the biggest problem is and what you're doing is helping them to see themselves as who they really are. Mm-hmm. People don't see themselves as renewed people, as reborn. And so they have all these issues and they identify themselves with all those issues.
Exactly.
They don't identify themselves with who they are in Christ.
Exactly. And not only that, now because they're identifying their problems, exactly, now they're waiting for revival.
Yes.
Waiting for revival to drop down from heaven. To change them, to transform them. But Word of God never says in any epistles that, you know, revival has to drop down from heaven to be transformed. God says, I have perfected you. You know the verse that says, you are perfected? Finished? In Hebrews 12. It's sanctified, you're perfected. Like you're done. Now, it's my responsibility to work out what God has put in me, work out his salvation. Work out. How can I work out if it's not in me? Mm-hmm. Work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Mm-hmm. Right? It does not say work in. I'm not waiting for grand heaven opening to work in, but work out your salvation. Very simple. Work out. That means salvation is there. And what is salvation? Sozo. Complete wholeness, peace, oneness. It's not just born again. Salvation is so we know that. Right? Work out yourself in fear and trembling. So, I just read that, and I didn't have time to respond to it because to me, if I respond, it would have been a long response with a bunch of scriptures and a bunch of backward statements. And if I just write 2 lines, it'll offend someone. And to me, that's not. Helpful. Because here's what I want to say before I get to the next point. 10 minutes. I had told this to 2 people recently. One person came and said, Ruben, I went to the person, I blasted the person out, the person was doing something wrong, and I cried to the person, and I said, okay. I said, how was the result? He said, no, didn't turn out well. So do you feel what you did was right? I gave a blast. I gave a strong rebuke. So why do you think that I blast the person out? I beat the person out. So I said, okay. I said, okay, let me just give you an example. I said, this is a patient there in the hospital, and he's a heart surgeon, and he goes to the operation room, and doctor operates on him for 8 hours, and the textbook perfect operation, and 8 hours, doctor came out, and then he gave a report to the family, you know what, 8 hours, I did by the textbook, I did a perfect operation, and the person died. Now, can you keep boasting about your operation if the person died? It's ridiculous. Right? It's ridiculous to boast about your operation. The patient died. Right? So I told his brother, I said, he's used to blast someone out. But what is the outcome? What was the outcome? What's the fruit? Right? What was the fruit of your work? I gave an example. I guess somebody was right. I said, don't focus on blasting, focus on outcome first. I want to see this outcome, and then be led by the Lord to do this. Don't focus on this. But so sometimes the Lord may say, be quiet. You understand? Sometimes the Lord will say, look, he's not ready for the soul blast yet. His soul's still weak. There's time for it. The Lord has told me a number of times in the past that if I wanted to correct someone, the Lord will hold me back. Because to me, a word given a season is so useful that maybe not a season. Right? So the Lord will hold me back, and I'll ponder about it, pray about it. Lord, please give an opening now to see, help the person out. And somehow within a day, so we something happened, and the person will come with that issue or something happened. And boom, the door is already open. The person's talking about it. And now when I bring it up, talk about it, it just graciously received. It's just right timing. Right? I like this passage when, after Christ's resurrection, the disciples had gone back to fishing. And they were the only ones to spread the gospel when they went back to fishing. But Christ came and said, children, do you need to eat? Then he knows the truth. He doesn't say that you know, blah, 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 you hopeless fellows, you know, you left me. Just. But no, children, you want meat, you eat. They had nothing. Come and eat. I have fish and bread for you. See, he never rebuked them. Because he knew in their state, they were not ready to get a rebuke yet. There are other times he rebuked, but this time he didn't rebuke. It's good to be led by the Spirit of God. Good to be led by the Spirit of God and with the outcome in mind and not realizing, you know, I've got to do this, and then become do's and don'ts. Right? Anyway, quiet mind. You haven't started out that yet.
That's okay. We've learned a lot.
Okay. I had a full study on it. And I want to teach on this. It's the, we're going to start it today. We'll get started, please. We'll get started, okay? We'll continue next Wednesday. What I would like to teach on this topic is I would like to teach this topic, like I said earlier, teach this topic in a way that you can, at least on a small scale, explain this to someone else. Okay, so you may not be able to explain like I do, with a lot of scriptures. That's okay. Totally fine. At least with few points to convince a fellow Christians who may disagree with you. You get it? So, right. So, what's the question here? Can Christians have demons inside? Now, the best way to learn this is by memory, to a point where, again, I'm not teaching this for you to just get information, but to get understanding. And now scripturally, to help someone out. See, if you can listen with that mentality, I need to know this to help someone out. Okay, because a lot of people don't believe this area, right? Is that true? Mm-hmm. Most don't. No, forget this. Poor Shaw went through persecution. He lost a bunch of friends and fellow Christians because they don't believe what he believes. Is that true, Shaw? He had a men's group study. They all disappeared. left him out because they don't believe. He told them, look, this happened to me. This is real. I've been through this. Guys, this is real. You can have freedom too. But they said, no. Such a resistance, such a sad. But if someone's willing, open, and that can happen over the phone, the text, at a given moment, So how can you convince someone through scriptures? Very quickly on this topic. Are you with me? Okay. Before we look at scriptures, here's a small article, cut up article, from a well-known Christian magazine called Charisma Magazine. It's mainly in the U.S., right? Small article. Anyone read this? No. Small article. It says, there was a time when we taught in our church that Christians could not have demons. I preached long sermons stating that Christians could be oppressed, repressed, obsessed, and suppressed, but never possessed, or never have demons inside. We believed that a demon could be outside a Christian, oppressing him, but it could not be inside of him. Right? This is like a big church in USA. The reasoning I used to defend this position was that Jesus and the Holy Spirit could not live inside the same body in which demons reside.
Makes sense.
Right.
We've all been taught that.
Right. Yeah. But see, it's one thing is to have comments of reasoning, which is good. But our comments of reasoning are not always agree with scriptures. Right? So this was a well-known pastor after many years. Many years.
It seems to me I've read this article.
Yeah. So then he says, the problem was our experience did not match our theology. That's the problem. Right? When we ministered deliverance, we frequently prayed for people we knew were born again, spirit-filled believers, and they manifested demons. We had to face the fact that either our experience was wrong or our doctrine was wrong. One thing you cannot deny, you can never deny, is experience. Impossible. If your leg grew 2 inches, you cannot deny that. If your back pain left, you cannot deny that. Right? If God blessed you with some financial blessing, you cannot deny that. Your demon screaming coming up, you cannot deny that. This is stupidity. Plain stupidity to deny that. What you see with your eyes. If someone denies, you know, this poor thing doesn't exist, it's stupid. You know, you must be blind. Right? We couldn't question our experience. Yeah, it's an impossible question. Because we knew that we were seeing. So we began to question our theology. Like I told you, I was pastoring a church in Chicago. It's a big church. So, and as far as casting of demons, it's never been taught in that church. Never been taught. And they had a few pastors before I was assigned there, looking at it. And this was before I went to Papua New Guinea. So from Chicago to Papua New Guinea. And when I taught this there, you can see, like, at least in the spirit, not literally, you can see people sitting like this. And that church was quite a wealthy church, and plus quite educated people. I think we had a few people with PhDs, a couple of people with masters. And if you go to take schooling in that regard, one skill you're trained is to think everything critically. Question things, analyze things, in a good way, right? So these people sitting up there and listening, not accepting. And it took third, fourth Sunday to fully accept, because I said I go to the scriptures. Right? But anyway, so we get a question on theology. We'll start with that next. In our search for truth, we realize that in the Bible, Jesus tells us to cast demons out, not to cast demons off. Right? That's a big difference. Out means off the inside. Obviously, for something to come out, it must be in. They finally came to the conclusion that our interpretation of the Bible had been wrong. Now I'm convinced, now this is very important, this is huge. Now I'm convinced that not only a Christian can have demons, but also that there are demons that operate in the realm of theology, encouraging us to argue and debate endlessly over doctrine that rather than meeting the needs of the people who are hurting. Demons actually help promote the teaching that a Christian cannot have a demon because they gain strength from staying hidden. They can operate in their destructive ways without being challenged. Right? Now, this is common among most churches. Casting out demons is something that's not taught at all. It's not taught. It's not practiced. But first you have to get understanding first before you can practice it. Right? So, it's sad. And so, it's my desire, hopefully, at least in the near future, something that the Lord leads, you will be teaching in some Christian groups this topic. And you'll say, let me explain some scriptures. Let me share something with you I learned. You know. And then and start teaching and then start helping people. Again, go back to the millennium comparison. Just comparison. Perfect peace because of demons. Right? And so that perfect inner peace. To me, there's nothing like it. Nothing like it. People often go for a vacation because they're so caught up in life and troubled and worried and failing, and they go to vacation. Hardly anything changes. Except the location, the geography changes. But the state of heart and mind, nothing much. They're unable to sit back and just enjoy life. I'm like deep inside. Right? I have come that they will have peace. It's going to stop me actually, because we're going to get into scriptures. So if you do come next Wednesday, we're going to go through scriptures about who a Christian is and in connection to the spirits, demons, and explain it and then give examples from scriptures with that support. And then go into a quick walk with it. Pretend someone else is asking a question, or someone is objecting or dissenting with you, you know, I can't believe it, and you want to convince the scriptures, and with the example from scriptures, convince a person. And with notes in front of you, and once you do it, that person can do it to you, and then we can do it without notes. Now, can I do this without notes? Yes, thank God I can. If someone asks me, say, I don't believe, I can thank God. Do it without notes, the whole thing without opening Bible, just quoting references. We have done it 100 times. And almost all the people that objected or disagreed or fought with me doctrinally that once I showed scriptures, not a single person won. Arguably, not a single person. Because who wants to fight against scriptures? Like, they are being named because the way they were brought up.
Yeah. And I think the idea always is that if you have if you've been taught that you can't have a demon if you're a Christian, then if you have a demon, then the thought comes, well, then I can't be a Christian.
Yeah.
You start questioning your
right.
The authenticity.
Right. We can look at that too and see it. So now someone sits in front of you and says that, can you, in a closed notebook, convince a person?
No.
Right.
Not yet.
So hopefully my next minister will train you when you do it. Right? One good role model was Christ, which was his role model for everything. But at the end of Gospel of Luke 24, those two disciples that were walking away from Jerusalem, they went to Emmaus, how they were sad, they were like downhearted. How he invisibly, so to speak, followed them from behind, right? But it says he expounded the scriptures.
Yeah.
Right? You think he was reading and said, let me turn to this, let me turn to this. No. Christ is expounding scriptures to them. And they were just listening.
Oh, okay.
And And then when Christ revealed himself to him, disappeared, they said, didn't our heart burn within us while he opened us the scriptures? So they said, the heart burned within us while he opened up the scriptures. So disciples, and they were sad, they needed help. So someone's objecting, right, or arguing with you, when you open up scriptures, something happened to the heart. Heart has been broken. It's burning. Scriptures, fire, just burning. They may not agree with you face to your face right away. Right? But maybe they call you, yeah.
Maybe they'll go home and research.
Yeah. I was blessed this last Sunday, this one big testimony, you know, stuff. I was chatting with Joe, Cheryl's husband, Altona, and they used to go, maybe it was still going, I'm not sure, Grace Superman? In Winkler, right, church? That church had a young couples group of gathering in Winkler, am I saying Winkler?
Yeah, it's
again. Last year. And the young couples, means like the couples in their early 20s, and some teenagers, and some early 30s. Young couples, many couples, and there were about 30 or 40 people there. And I was invited to speak. I was invited to speak one evening. And so I met the leader, and I want to teach about Holy Spirit. And so I went there, like, the scriptures all lined up in my head, and I said, all lined up in my head. And when I got up to speak, it was dark, the seats, I couldn't see anything. It was just, I got up, it's like outside, the backyard. And the sun was setting, and you couldn't read anything. So people just listening, not reading much. And so here I'm going with verse 1, blah, 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 like an AK-47 shooting verses about Holy Spirit for an hour and a half or 2 hours. And I felt some resistance. Some were like objecting, and they asked some just strange questions like, why is it recorded in the Bible that Jesus spoke in tongues and stuff like that? And, you know, kind of prove that speaking tongues is not so important, blah, blah, blah. So anyway, I give the answers possible. And then I asked the question with the question. I said, well, why didn't Jesus baptize people? And so they had answers. So Christ and they didn't baptize people. Doesn't mean that we don't baptize now. So that's because it's not recorded in speaking tongues, we should not speak in tongues. But he did say he won't speak in new tongues. He would teach it anyway. And so then when I met Joe, so I thought, I must have been hard on those people. You know? So I feel a little bad that I might have overloaded their mind with the truth, you know, like overemphasized, overloaded. But then Joe said he met with them a few days ago, a few weeks ago, and some from the group, listen to it, he said, we're open to the Holy Spirit, we're speaking tongues. So what he said, Ruben, don't feel bad. You put the seed in. And so same way with this, it's you can put the seed into people, not to win a debate, but to help them. Right? Because to me, gospel is simple. Love God, love people. Mm-hmm. Love God, love people. That's the gospel. It's not to win a debate in the army. Love God, love people. And loving people is to help other problems. So next Sunday, next Wednesday, we will go through this and more like an exercise. We'll learn it from next study. 45 minutes from now, we'll go through scripture after scripture after scripture and examples. And we'll see if we can do it with notes first and then without notes. It's easier than you think. Because if you don't do it here, how do you go up there?